the recognition, the realization came today that the spiritual path is, it's all about facing the truth that makes us uncomfortable and getting used to that, getting used to it. You see, truth makes the ego feel very uncomfortable, very uncomfortable. And so when we hear the truth, the ego gets, oh, wow. And we get worried. And we say, well, we don't want to make the ego too uncomfortable. But yes, we do. It's like a workout. So you're supposed to feel stressed, strained. You're uncomfortable with hearing the truth. For instance, understanding is insanity. Hearing that. Understanding is insanity. Or I choose to gamble on no gambling. I'm going to gamble on not gambling. I'm going to take a gamble on not gambling. It's like, So when we get this level of discomfort, we recognize this is a wow. This is the spiritual path. It's not about just hearing nice spiritual platitudes that make us feel smile and say, oh, that's nice. So the spiritual path is difficult. It's more discomfort than difficultness. It's just like working out, like jumping rope. I just knocked out 100. Been doing that regularly now, and you know, it's a little bit discomforting. You get to feel tired, but you know, it's being beneficial. Same thing with the spiritual path. You have to keep hearing what you're not comfortable with, as long as it's true. Uncomfortable truth. That just makes you just kind of simmer a little bit, burn, just like, wow. I'm going to gamble on not gambling. The ego hates this. It says, you can't say that. That's a contradiction. Like nails on a chalkboard to the ego. And yet we love it. I'm going to take a gamble on not gambling. This is what I was saying today. And wow, did that hit hard. So it made me feel very on edge. Let's gamble on not gambling. So there's part of the pretend mind that just says, no, can't do that. It's just that I won't allow it. It doesn't make any sense. You're contradicting. No. We just say, yes, we will say this and listen to it and hear it and say it over and over again. Like jumping a rope, hop. I'm going to gamble on not gambling. I'm not going to take the gamble that any aspect of lies can be true, or that any aspect of lies can ever bring us true contentment. I'm going to gamble on that. Take a gamble that gambling doesn't work. Gambling on the ego doesn't work. I'm going to take a gamble on that. So again, this is the last thing the ego wants to hear us say. So the burn, I call it the burn. There's a sort of inner burn going on. Slow burn. So this is what I've done in my whole life, is keep on looking for deeper and deeper truths and to get to feel this discomfort and then get used to the discomfort of this truth, and gradually the continuity fear evaporates, and ultimately when you hear it later on, it's like, oh yeah, I feel perfectly fine with that. And then you look for something deeper and keep going like that. This is how it is. So it's not easy. I was reading something by Shakyamuni Buddha last night, and talks about the path. I've never read this before, and he talks about the gradualism of it in terms of, in a very interesting way, that just seems to ring true with my own experience. Now, it is interesting to note that Bud is awareness, our awareness of being, awareness of being, of our natural being, awareness of natural being. And Buddha is one who is aware of natural being. Or Bodhi, also Bodhi's awareness, B-O-D-H-I, Bodhi, Bod, B-O-D-H, Bod, or Bud. It's really the same word. Bodhi, Sattva, awareness of natural being, one who is aware of natural being, Buddha, one who is aware of natural being. So Shakyamuni Buddha was just one who was aware of natural being, beingness. That's all. There were many before, and there will be many after. In fact, all of us will be that. It's just a word that means awareness of natural being. One who is aware of natural being. The awareness of natural being. Awareness of isness. Awareness of nowness. That's all that means. It wasn't a special. Someone different than what we are. Or anything like that. It's just but he was able to give out very clear teachings. But any of us can do this because it's self-evident that we go through it and we realize, yeah, the path is this ordeal of hearing the truth that it makes us uncomfortable. See, I'm not comfortable with that. That's what practice is. So we're always practicing on the path. We're always practicing. When we're hearing, whatever we're hearing, listening to, paying attention to, we're always looking for that spiritual uncomfortableness, that uncomfortableness with what we're hearing because it's so true. It is so true. And when we feel, oh, I'm not comfortable with that, then we say, great. Just sort of breathe into that. And don't try to get rid of it, but just allow that to just marinate in that and feel the burn and feel the wow of it. That's the only secret there is, really, is to just do this. It's like jumping rope. What's the secret? Just doing it. Just do it is the secret. Everybody's looking for, well, you know, discussing jumping rope. What kind of technique do I need to use on that? And they'll spend, you know, a lifetime discussing technique of possible technique for jumping rope and never jump rope at one time. I don't worry about technique, jumping rope. I just do it. Jump. And you kind of figure out something that works as you go along, but you know, it's just a matter of doing it. It's more important than worrying about the technique. Same thing with the spiritual path. Doing it is way more important than worrying about the technique or analyzing this or analyzing that. Or way, way more important. So you may just be sitting there quietly and you're just in this burn, just wow, I can't believe it. Understanding is insanity, which is true. What is there that stands under being, to understand being? There are no levels to truth. There's no way to be underneath being, understanding, to stand under. It's like, oh, okay, now I'm standing under being. There is no understanding of being. There is no understanding of being. There's only experiencing. Being, experiencing being. There's no being, understanding being. It's impossible. So the whole notion of understanding is insanity. Absolutely, it is insanity. And here we've been thought that I need to understand. So we hear this, understanding is insanity. And it's like, nails on a chalkboard. Wonderful, nails on a chalkboard. This is what you want to hear. It's a workout. And there are certain times as we go along where we have the zest for a workout. I'm in that mode now because of the imminent pressures that we're under, the troubles that we're under, troubles to come. And time to work out here. So, you know, let it all surface, this uncomfortableness with truth. And give it a go. It's not that we say, oh, I'm supposed to feel comfortable with this. If I'm not, oh, I'm doing it wrong or something, wrong technique. That's like saying, oh, I'm supposed to be able to jump rope and be effortless and not feel anything. If I'm not, it's a wrong technique. No, we're supposed to feel the burn because we're doing it. The doing it is the technique. So jumping rope is the technique of jumping rope. Okay. So being is the technique of being. Now is the technique of now. And I like to say, put that in your pipe and smoke it. Now is the technique of now. Being is the technique of being. Now, if we really, really hear this and accept it, that this is true, then part of us is like shaking and saying, wow. Very uncomfortable with it. All our smartness is very uncomfortable with the truth. Smartness is profoundly uncomfortable with truth. And therein is the problem. You see in the world many who are smart with in all sorts of ways. Some smart in ways of spirituality. But they can't practice. They can't get to practice because they're so uncomfortable. It makes smartness feel very uncomfortable. But for us, we enjoy that. It's a enjoyable discomfort. It's a discomfort of smartness evaporating. Now is the technique of now. There is no other technique. It's an affront to our smartness, is it not? Absolutely, smartness feels very much affronted and will defend itself. And play smart or dumb, which is another strategy that smartness does, is playing dumb. But here we just hold the feet of smartness to the fire until it decides to flee, is no more, it vanishes without a trace. It, and smartness is always saying, oh, you could do more than that. You're smarter than that. Come on, you're smarter than that. You know then you've got smartness right where you want it when it starts making these excuses like this. To say, no, I don't want to be smart. I want to be a genius. I'm employing my genius here, not smartness. Genius is the technique of genius. So, yeah, I'm knocking out 100 reps on the jump rope now just regularly. Decide, oh, let me go out and do jump rope. How long does it take to do 100? Maybe, I don't know, 2-3 minutes or something, not very long. Knock it out and then go about your business, and then later on do it again, go about your business. It's like that with the spiritual path. You just keep knocking it out. It's like batting practice. Keep knocking the ball out of the park. All day long, I search for the next uncomfortable truth. That which makes smartness feel uncomfortable, very uncomfortable, profoundly uncomfortable. And this guy has to be some genius. And the genius emerges. It emerges by saying something like understanding is insanity. Now, smartness is never going to say this. And the ways of looking at it that genius presents to us, we say, like, I never would have thought of that, meaning smartness would never have thought of that. Now this I is a pretend I. The ego claims there's an I, and it teaches you all these reactions based on what it thinks is the body. It says you need to react this way, and then it says, well, these are all these reactions. This is your I. This is your identity. What? It has nothing to do with our identity. It tries to give us all these memories and reactions and thoughts about the reactions, etc., and then claims this is your identity. This is your I. This is what you are. This is, again, nothing to do with what we are. We let all those things go. The ego tries to build a self. Calls it the personality. Build a self. We don't need a personality. So we don't need all these reactions and thoughts about the reactions and memories based on reactions. We don't need those. The ego says, well, you lose your identity. No. It's never an identity in the first place at all. Just a ragtag clump of pebbles, you know, like that. It's like holding some pebbles in our hand and think that that's our identity. It's not. But the ego cherishes it. Because the ego that doesn't exist believes in a non-existent identity too. Cherishes the idea of a non-existent identity. The ego says, what will I do without a non-existent identity? Well, not much, that's for sure. The ego wants to say it's greater than that. We say, well, I'm denying the non-existent identity, or I'm fighting against it, I'm trying to get free of it or something. That's the ego. There is no non-existent identity. The ego maintains its belief in its superiority. Say, well, I'm better than non-existent identity, because I'm warring against it, fighting against it or something. But here we just say, well, it's never existed at all. There's nothing we need to do. Nothing we need to understand. The ego says it's trying to understand it and, you know, put it in therapy and heal it. You're trying to heal the non-existent identity, trying to heal it. The ego says, oh, I'm so useful. You need me. Only I can heal the non-existent identity. Now, shifting gears. As we go, you know, looking for this discomfort to make smartness very uncomfortable, spiritually uncomfortable. Well, smartness is making a huge push to eliminate spiritual truth altogether in this world, so smartness can feel comfortable here. This is the tech people. This is the new age people. This is the generations that have come in recently. They want to create a smart utopia. Utopia where smartness feels right, that it's comfortable, nothing's threatening it. It feels unthreatened. This is what they're after. They don't trust men either. It's funny. I had a situation today where some lady pulled up in the car with the dog, and someone said, "Ah, well, wait a minute. The dog doesn't like men. I gotta do something here. Like, the dog doesn't like men." It's funny. Because most of the Buddhas, the awakened ones, ones who awaken to their identity, most, percentage-wise, have been what we would say appearing as men. And most religious leaders, again, throughout history, have those who speak this inconvenient truth to smartness, uncomfortable, make smartness uncomfortable, have been men. And the ego hates that. It says, get rid of men. Let's put them under lock and key and shut them up. And so there's just been this very, very huge effort to basically stuff men in a prison. Imprison them, their voices, and you don't hear them anymore. You just don't hear. I mean, I'm looking for, is anybody else speaking up? No, not really. Few here and there, but it's astonishing, the evaporation of the male voice in this world. They're just parroting the female voice now, basically, which is, hey, let's find a way to get comfortable with smartness. We can do it. Let's make this house, the house of smartness, a home. We know how to do it. We can decorate it so we'll feel content, true contentment with smartness. And so the courage of men to speak the truth in this world and make others' smartness uncomfortable has almost vanished here, almost vanished. And people are scared to listen to it. I mean, wise women used to listen to that, enjoy it, absolutely, because it's very helpful to hear that. Very helpful. Now you don't hear, you don't see. Some, there are still wise women who say, yeah, This is what I want to hear. I want to make this feel this make smartness very uncomfortable. And get used to that. Get more and more used to that. But as a society as a whole, as a culture as a whole, the world's going to hell. There's no question about it. There's no greater hell than trying to get comfortable with smartness. Trying to understand the false self. That is truly a prison. A very bad prison. I've been to Spark It yesterday. And there's this song playing. And say, hey, I know that song. I was just talking about it. Three Dog Night on the road to Shambhala. Everybody's happy. Everybody's kind. We're on the road to Shambhala. Well, I hope so. But I can tell you this, that it's very uncomfortable. This path, spiritual path, is extraordinarily uncomfortable for smartness, because there is no realm for smartness to dwell in. It has no realm, which is why it's frantically trying to make this world its home. The smartness is always saying, oh, we got to make this world a better place. Because it doesn't have a realm. It doesn't have being at all. Smartness is not at all. It's a denial. It's being, pretending it's not being, is what we call smartness. How can not being have a realm? Being is realmness. That's all. That is realmness. Isness is what a realm is. That's it. There's no upper and lower and side to it at all. You cannot stand under it. There's no under or above or side. It's all a smooth, smooth, smooth continuum of truth. All truth is perfectly true. All truth is perfectly true. You cannot voyage somewhere and discover somewhere where truth is less true, someplace where truth is less true. So from the standpoint of truth, which is all there is, it's this perfectly smoothed out smoothness, like a perfect continuum. And that's all there is in regard to truth. There's no perspective from which to judge it. It's not possible to judge truth. There's no perspective from where to judge. How can we judge? We are truth. There's only truth. 100% pure truth is all there is. And pretense is nothing at all. So there's just this unwillingness now in the world to speak this uncomfortable truth. I've tried to do it as much as possible in my life and been ostracized. And people just say, I don't want to be around him. No. He's going to say something that will make me feel uncomfortable. I always had the courage to do so, but people end up like shunning you. They don't want anything to do with you, which is stupid. So stupid. So this is what the world fails to grasp, that you should squirm in your seat when the pastor, the priest, or the rabbi, or whoever is delivering the talk, the guru, the this and this and that. Of course, different traditions use different terms, but you're supposed to go, this is really hitting home. It's like, oh my gosh, they're talking about, my quote-unquote sins, the sins which is smartness, and pointing out this and what I do. And, oh, but this is very helpful. And there's been this great tradition of those who speaking this inconvenient truth. Now, uncomfortable truth, it is inconvenient too, but that's stealing from Al Gore. But it's a good phrase, isn't it? Inconvenient truth, uncomfortable truth. What a great tradition. This is absolutely essential in this world. And this is the tradition that is being sabotaged in this world. It is sabotage. It's sabotage that is taking place in this world. This world is a place that's right now being sabotaged. These people into coming in this mindset. These are saboteurs. These are saboteurs. Absolutely they are. They want to be comfortable with smartness. This is their God. They've made an idol out of smartness. And looking back, wow, once we get free of this, it'll just be, wow, we can hardly believe it. What a wretched place this world is now. The mentality here is just so wretched. They're so overconfident. Smartness is just a bully, overconfident bully. And, oh boy, I live in the heart of it, Silicon Valley. I come across these people all the time, this mindset. And, you know, you're like nothing to them. What genius? What's that? We have no idea what that. What are you talking about? It sounds like you're just a crazy, mythical foolishness you're talking about. And smartness is always measuring, is it not? You want to know a genius move? I'll tell you, here's a genius move. I have my golf balls. And needed to mark them so I can identify my golf balls. I've always been thinking, what kind of marking do I want to put on? I never feel comfortable with that. I said, what? Dots or line, whatever. And today this genius thought came to me straight on the wings of the Holy Spirit. And what I did was I got this whiteout, you know, the whiteout for correcting typing typos or whatever. And of course with computers people don't use that so much anymore, do they? But I found a new use for whiteout. What I did was I whited out the numbers on the golf balls. It says Titleist 5, for instance. So I take the white out and I whited out the 5 on each side of the golf ball, so the golf balls don't have any numbers on them. So I've never heard of this before. But so this is my marking on the golf ball is no marking. I white out the numbers. And it's like, wow. I mean, I'd never thought of that before. It never crossed my mind. I'm thinking, how do I mark it? What kind of marking? Instead, I remove the marking. I remove the numbers. And that's the marking, you see. That's the identification. Is less identification. No identification with numbers. No identification with smartness. White out the numbers. So again, Silicon Valley is the heart of smartness. To this sabotage, really the heart of the saboteurs. This is their headquarters. They're sabotaging the world. They absolutely are. And so this is calling them out. This is the truth. And this is an uncomfortable truth, is it not? The willingness to speak this type of uncomfortable truth, that is love in action. That's compassion. That is compassion, which is love in action. Compassion is love in action. And to bring this up and be able to speak it, and of course I realized that, you know, the world will you know, ostracize me. They might ban me from traveling to their country. Well, or so, well, that would be I don't want to be smart about that. I hope nobody bans me. But, you know, that might be an honor and a privilege to be humorous about it. Someone decides, no, you can't come to our country. We worship smartness here. How dare you come here? How dare you speak truth? Pretty soon, I'll be banned from the world, for sure, which is great. I'll ban myself first, though. Yeah. White out the numbers. Wow. I just said, Holy Spirit, that's a genius move, to say the least. And what smartness was saying, well, wait a minute, that's going to affect the aerodynamics of the ball. And I said, really? Really? How much? Really? A thin little film there is, oh, the ball's just going to, what, knuckle on me or something? No. Am I really so great that the, you know, a millionth of an effect on the ball, a tiny fragmental effect on the ball, it's going to ruin my golf game or something? Are you kidding me? So smartness tried to raise objections, and I said, objections overruled. Genius overruled the objections of smartness. So be the judge. Only judge there is be the genius judge and overrule smartness. It keeps objection. You say objection overruled. And smartness says, well, I can't play golf with those balls. What are you kidding me? It's going to ruin my game. Oh, good. And I want smartness's game to be ruined. There's not no game at all. I don't need it. I'll play the genius game instead. So I'm making little adjustments every day, more and more. And this is what we have to do. This is one of them. Let genius make the adjustments. Let your genius make the adjustments. Everyone's a genius, spiritual genius. They just have to allow it to have influence and overrule smartness. Right now, smartness, people are putting their faith, gambling on smartness and making that the judge and saying, genius overruled. You know, not going to do that. We're going to go with the smartness. Hey, Siri, you know, what should I do? Oh, yes, that sounds smart. Yeah, this is the way they're deciding to go. They'd rather listen to Siri than the Holy Spirit. And of course, smartness says, well, let's do both. But secretly, smartness says, yeah, but I know I'm smarter than that. Well, of course, smartness is smarter than genius. But of course, smartness is insanity. So you might say, really saying that smartness is more insane than genius? Yeah, of course. 100%, completely more. Because the genius is not insane at all. So smartness is always trying to get the best. It thinks it's in competition with genius. There's no competition. Genius is not in competition with smartness at all. It just sees that smartness is completely insane. This is compassion, not competition. So we have this rescue effort of compassion here, rescuing us from smartness, the kingdom of smartness, the anti-kingdom, the anti-realm of smartness, trying to establish a realm outside of being, knowing it has no home in being whatsoever, saying, well, that's okay, we'll build a realm, build a shell around us. So the good thing about this time is we're getting exposed to this, all the smartness, and we can just judge it and say, genius says, no, I don't need that. I don't know why. I don't need it. That's nothing to see here. Let's move on from this. Yeah. When the great Tibetan monastics would decide it's time to drop this body appearance, they'd sew them up in their little tent, their little yurt, or whatever they use, wherever they were, and wait for about a week or so. Then they'd open it up, there'd be nothing left but some hair and some fingernails. Body would just turn into light, not turn into it, but just would now be expressing as light, the light body, the formless light body. Sambhogakaya, Sambhogakaya, there's the Dharmakaya, Sambhogakaya, something like that, and the Nirmanakaya, something like that. The bodies of being, so to speak. And it's not really important to dig into that. It's not really that important. I was reading Tibetan Buddhism last night. I realized it's not really important. This is not really practice. This is more food for smartness to try and differentiate. There's been a lot of differentiation throughout history. And too much. Genius already knows the truth, so don't worry about it. But this, when genius is fully in charge, and we accept genius, accepts a genius not pretending to not be, the body just expresses now as light. And sometimes they would just start glowing and just turn to light and tend to rise up in the sky and just disappear as beautiful light. And they can reappear that way also. Absolutely, they can simply reappear that way to us. This is very common in Tibetan Buddhism. Whole cultures was aware of this, and many, many, many people had contact with all these experiences. So how impoverished are we today in our culture? I tell you, we're living in the ghetto. Okay. Maybe that's what Elvis was singing about, the ghetto. Yeah, we're living in the ghetto. We're living in a ghetto, a spiritual ghetto. We are spiritual ghetto dwellers. Very, very, very wretched hovels we're living in. Terrible ghetto existence, of course, but people are fiercely proud of this spiritual ghetto. You know, it says, we're smart. We don't have any lifetime experiences with spiritual situations. I hardly do it all myself, except my own experiences. It's crazy. It's wretched. It's a disgrace. It's an utter disgrace, actually. This is utterly disgraceful living that we're experiencing now. Yeah, we go to the mall, we go to the fast food, we drive in our modern car with, you know, the smart stuff and everything. And this is disgraceful. And yet we go through our whole lives and not one time do we ever come across someone turning into a light body, for instance. Someone absorbed in non-dual abidance, in abidance in truth. And on and on and on. No one ever comes across this. This is living in a dark prison, actually. Dark prison cell. We have no idea of how imprisoned we are right now. What a wretched black hole that we're living in right now. I mean, I get so... I can't even say the word, apoplectic or something. Furious. I get so furious. about my own life. So what in the world, Holy Spirit, are you doing? I really chew it out. I said, where is my experiencing of these situations? How can I get used to it if I don't experience it? This is crazy. This culture is crazy. There's this Buddhist center. I said, wow, maybe I need to look into this. And I read all the reviews and everything. I said, oh my God, you know, it's just so completely secular. It's crazy. I don't know anything anyone talks about is the festivals and all the good food and wine and getting drunk and enjoying and, you know, this marriage counseling and this. And I said, oh my God. I said, holy cow. I thought maybe I might go there. I might meet someone who's, you know, non-dual abidance. But in the Tibetan Buddhist culture and in the Hindu culture, I mean, you come across extraordinary spiritual realizations throughout your life, and this is a part of the fabric of your experiencing. Here we go to you know, Mickey D's takeout, go to a pizza parlor, watch Monday Night Football or something, and then like, wow, you know, we're cool. This is so cool. We look up something on the smartphone. We think, this is the fabric of our experiencing. There's just it's just smartness. It's just brutality. It's a brutal life that we're living now. Very brutal. We'll look back on this at some point, and we will hardly be able to believe that we were so brutalized. We brutalized ourselves to such an extent. And it's reaching low tide point, to say the least. It's very much a low tide. Bottom of the barrel. Coming up upon the bottom of the barrel. Where lying is seen as smartness, of course. This is why we'll elect the liar in chief. We keep electing better and better liars in chief. Because they're so smart. Look how they lied their way out of that thing, lied their way out of this, and lied about this, and lied about this, and just brushed it off. Say, oh, well, just with another lie, better lie. And everyone say, well, that's so smart. Because what is smartness but lying about truth? It's all that it is. It's all that it is. And so this is my torture, is that everybody follows liars in this world. And if you just tell the truth, nobody wants to listen to you. I said, well, that's not so smart. I don't think that's smart. No, of course it's not. It's true. They look at Ron and Archie and say, well, he's stupid. What's he doing? He's not being smart. What's so smart about that? That's what they look at. What's so smart about that? Nothing smart about it. It's pure genius. That's what's right about it. What's right about smartness? Nothing, really. Nothing, really. Nothing at all. He just sets up straw men and he works on those and claims how smart it is. Oh, look what I did. I healed a sick body or something. Well, it's smartness to set up the body in the sickness in the first place. It's a reflection of insanity. And it just manipulates, illusions manipulating illusions. So it's easy to be lazy. Maybe I'll be lazy later on tonight. Listen to some music or something. That's being lazy. Really, it is. And what takes the initiative is to speak this uncomfortable truth. And hear it, listen to it, you know. Be affected by it deeply. It's a workout, spiritual workout. And this, you know, radical Dzogchen's helpful, the Tibetan Buddhism and radical Dzogchen, because for them, this is just a matter of this is of life, this is how it is. It's they're just talking about what happens, this, and they're experiencing, and sure, this went here, did this, and this, and this, and this, and this, and he's kind of like, what are you talking about, what? I never heard of such a thing. So it's just so nonchalant. They're so matter of fact and nonchalant and just straightforward. It's like Longchenpa. It's just like you said what? How can you say that? You know, it's so easily. Wow. But for them, of course. So we're spiritual idiots right now. We truly are. This culture is totally gung-ho about seeing what great idiots they can be. How great idiocy can become. Let's all become total idiots is their goal. So white out the numbers. I love that. That's one of the Holy Spirit's best moves ever. The Holy Spirit says, why not just white out the numbers? What? I said, what? I said, but I love it. Is it possible? Can I do that? Can I really do it? I'm going to ruin the golf ball. What happens if I hit it with the club? Huh? Maybe a little chip off. I'll white it out again. Objections overruled. Wow, maybe we could just start whiting out a lot of stuff. How about that? Just have to carry this white out with us. Interesting. Yeah. Maybe on your phone, on the white out the Apple logo on your phone or something. Just white it out. Or whatever your phone happens to be. Just white out the logo. Just put a white circle. White it. Just put a circle where, you know, white out over the Apple. Why not? Why not do these little actions that are loyal to genius? Why not? What do we have to lose? Only thing we have to lose is our smartness, which is insanity. I think I'm going to get a bottle of that white out. We'll see. Yeah. What else can we white out? See, genius knows that we don't need a realm outside of being. Being isness, because there, it's impossible. Why pursue such madness? We don't need this kind of realm. We don't need to try to build a realm out of reactions. What is this world but reactions? To heat, to pressure, right? To these density, to energy, energy reactions. Energy reacting to energy. We don't need that. We don't need energy reacting to energy. It's electromagnetism. We don't need that. It's an attempt to build a realm that's separate from being. And so when we hear all this, we're committed to sitting quietly, committed to not doing anything. Just feel the burn. Wow. It's tough. Right now I want to feel like, eat something or do something. It's hitting hard right now. Keeping my weight down. I'm keeping my weight down somehow. Every morning I fear the worst and say, oh, well, it's not so bad. Keeping good habits going, not listening to the radio. I turned on the radio for only the second time maybe in the last 8 months or so. I really stopped listening to the radio, cold turkey. And this time I was doing some boring job, and I said, well, let me maybe get the sports report or something. Well, I turned it on, immediately here's this guy talking about gambling. That's all they could talk about. I mean, it's just, same old wretched content. I got so upset, turned it off. So that's it. No more. It's gotten worse, worse, worse. Everything relates back to gambling. In Vegas, and, you know, just sleaze. It was such a sleazy, sleazy stuff. And I just said, that's it. So I'm tempted to turn the radio. I said, no, I'm not going to turn on the radio. It's off. It's on off mode. So very good habit. I've also mastered the habit of going on to Bing. One computer I use is on Bing, the homepage, and not looking at the bottom bar where all the news is. I simply don't look at it. I just decide I'm not going to look at it. I don't. I don't even look at the faces. I don't even glance to see what the faces may be or nothing. I look up what I want to type in, which is just going to some weather channel. And basically, the only thing I check is the weather channel and maybe two other places or so. But sports. Yeah, the sports scores or whatever, and just maybe golf. I check golf today and see how Jordan Spieth was doing. He's doing great. He's a wonder kind. I didn't know he putted cross-handed. Isn't that amazing? I've followed his career from the get-go, and no one ever pointed out he puts cross-handed. What in the world? And finally, there's a little blurb says, his cross-handed putting is working great. I said, what are you talking about? I never noticed that. No one's ever brought it up. They talk about his forward press. They talk about him looking at the hole when he's putting, but he never said he puts cross-handed. I said, holy cow. I used to try it. It actually works quite well. It really does. But it seems a little, it's just that it's not orthodox, so we don't do it. But maybe I'm going to do that. I may try that. I may try putting cross-handed. It works. It really does. I mean, he's putting as well now as anybody's ever putted in the history of the game. I mean, it's just extraordinary. So I just checked out that and the weather, and said, oh, it's going to rain tomorrow a little bit. Okay. And that's it. That's it. I try to limit, and then YouTube do these, but I try to limit, and occasionally Wikipedia, I'll look up something. Some bogakaya. What's that mean? Some, you know, etheric body, light body, you know, whatever. Forget it. Forget about it. Forget about it. Just keep plowing ahead here with taking a look at smartness and recognizing what's going on. Let's not compete with the Tibetan Buddhists, okay? We're not in competition with them. Because really, the masters, they would say, what are you talking about? Don't worry about it. There is no such thing. Really. Ultimately. There's only the Dharmakaya, really. These are just metaphors, sort of, you know, don't try to pin it down and be smart about it. Don't try to be smart about it. Don't try to be smart about it. Be a genius. Be the genius that we all are. That's all. That's all they're talking about. But smartness, of course, gets hold of all religious, all spiritual teaching, and spins out these religions based on that. They think they're being smart. So, well, this is really smart. We're really smart. Dharma just means all truth, ultimate truth. Being isness, the truth. At least in Tibetan Buddhism, it means different things, different places. The word can mean all sorts of different things, you know. So why worry about what does it mean? Let's just experience. Experience is the technique of experiencing. Experiencing is the technique of experiencing. This is what's more important to hear. More important than the Dharma. What's the Dharmakaya? What's the Sambhogakaya? What's the Nirmanakaya? Experiencing is the technique of experiencing. Now is the technique of now. That's all we need to hear. Now is the technique of now. Now, within their culture and their mode of practice, all that stuff is very valid for them to look at. It's not so valid for us to look at, actually. It isn't. We have our way of going about it. And we have to deal with our cultural situation, which is quite, quite different, actually, in many respects. The wow is sufficient. Full stop on the wow is sufficient. Now is the technique of now. Just abide in the genius. The genius of genius. Not the genius of smartness. Smartness is always trying to be a genius at smartness. Genius is not trying to be a genius at smartness. It's being a genius at being a genius. You get this differentiation here. Very important. Just hear it. You hear it. Don't get it. Hear it. Like you've been... It's like you walk outside and you're walking out to your car and you look up and there's this huge full moon just right in front of you. And you weren't thinking, oh, wow. You're struck by it. Like that. Be struck by it. Be awestruck by it. Be startled by it. The truth. Be startled by it. What? But then say, oh, wow, look at that moon. It's so amazing. Wow. He got up in the morning, in a December morning, super cold, clear morning, and early in the morning, driving, and say, look, oh, there's the moon on the western horizon. Oh, it was so, so unexpected and startling. But I just loved it. I said, wow, this is really a very strong wow. It's like that. Unexpected. Come across genius. Oh, what is that? White out the numbers on my golf ball. What? Can I do that? Is that allowed? Can I go out on the golf course with whited out numbers on a golf ball? I don't think there's any rule that says you have to have numbers on your golf ball. You can't white them out. I hope there isn't. Maybe they'll make a rule. Golf is pretty good at making rules for every possible contingency. They finally took one off the books, I think, a couple off the books. If the ball moves inadvertently without, if you're addressing it and the wind's like a burst of gust of wind comes and the ball oscillates or something, it's not a penalty stroke. Because, I mean, what could you do? I mean, that's the dumbest rule ever. They finally said, okay. And there's something else too. If you're standing at a dress and the ball's in a hazard, I think, and it moves, and not due to any intent on your part or anything like that, or action or intent on your part, also I believe that's not a penalty anymore. Hallelujah. So smartness is making up all these rules. You can't be a genius. There's no genius allowed here in this world. Genius is not allowed. This world's like a little tree fort with a sign. Genius is not allowed. No genius is allowed. This is the world. Little sign. A tree fort. You know, the kids go through that phase. No older kids allowed. No adults allowed. No, this. Here's no geniuses allowed. Makes us feel uncomfortable, they say. We feel uncomfortable with that. Geniuses are insecure. Makes us feel insecure. Makes us, hurts our self-esteem. Self-esteem of smartness. We're trying to build up our self-esteem here. Build a self. Trying to build a self. A new self, and that genius hurts our efforts. We feel like, what's the use? Oh, maybe I can't do this. Oh, well, yeah, maybe we can't do the impossible. They don't want that pointed out. They don't want to point out that we can't accomplish the impossible. They say, no, we're crunching the numbers right now. The odds are the answer's bound to pop out, spit out of that computer at some point. Got all the supercomputers crunching the numbers. We'll turn the whole world into a supercomputer. Whole universe. And the odds are we're going to find the answer. How to do the impossible. No, the odds are there are no odds. There is no answer. How can there be odds when there's no answer? How can there be odds in finding an answer that can never exist? That's impossible. There's no odds. Not even zero odds. Just no odds. I mean, we could speed zero, but even zero is, it's even beyond that. It just, there's no, it's utter whimsicality. So yeah, I'm out here, and it's 11 o'clock at night, and it's cold. It's January, was it 8th today, something like that? It might be the 8th, yeah, 8th, and it's very cold. It's not terrible cold, but it's cold, so it's uncomfortable. But okay, I'm out here speaking. It was very, it makes Spartans feel very uncomfortable. So I'm uncomfortable. Well, it's a workout. People go to the gym every day. Why can't we go to the spiritual gym every day? Well, what is it that's preventing everybody from doing that? It's ridiculous. Like, what other utter wimps? This world is full of just utter wimps. There's no, I don't know what else to say. It's pathetic. Smart geeks, wimps, I don't know, they're all just, they can't do an hour at the spiritual gym every day because it hurts their self-esteem. Yeah. It, you know, this is the pigsty. The pigs are wallowing in the mud here of smartness. Smartness is just mud. guided spiritual gym. Wow. They can put in 8 hours of television watching, but not 1 hour of the spiritual gym. Oh no, it's too heavy for me. You know, I cannot lift it. Oh no. How can you expect me to do this? You know, it's too difficult, too heavy. I cannot lift that heavy weight. But you can lift 8 hours of television every day. Oh yeah, but that makes me feel comfortable being smart. So we need to be aware of this. This is how bad the world is. It is catastrophically terrible. So I don't know what to say. I could keep talking, but there's no cultural movement really in this direction at all. It's the completely opposite, and you cannot. It's very difficult when there's no fabric, cultural, spiritual, cultural fabric at all. Very difficult. So I've always tried to talk in just matter-of-fact ways about all the, you know, the miracles of the spiritual path and what happens and all this. Since I was born, I just would talk about it constantly. This is my constant topic of conversation. And to me, it was just a matter-of-fact, of course they did this, of course they did that, of course I believe this. This piece of cake, what are you talking about? And everybody just eventually just said, wow, I don't want to listen to that stuff anymore. And so, yeah, I got depressed and nobody wanted to listen to it. But at least here I'm able to speak up and some are listening. Thank you very much. Much appreciated. Not only from me, but from everyone, actually. Because ultimately the momentum here will, at some point, will expand and extend in many ways. And many will be helped. This is what Ramana Maharshi told me. Many, many will be very, very much helped by the momentum of this thing, which he has helped build, along with others too, and other Buddhas, other awakened ones, other enlightened ones, other saved ones, other redeemed ones, however you want to call it, all right? So, those who are listening, are paying attention, putting themselves to going to spiritual gym every day, well, it's fabulous, absolutely fabulous. True spiritual superstars, to do this in this climate here. Wow. Speaking of that, it was like, you know, going through this bitter cold spell here in California. It's bitter. In December, look up, we're cutting this rose bush way back, and there's this beautiful rose blooming. What? And today I looked at someone else's yard there, and there's the roses all over the rose bushes. I said, what is going on? Yeah. But right here, this beautiful rose. I said, wow. A rose can bloom even in winter, can't it? Yes, it can. So there are those that are still blooming in this most harsh Siberian winter here in this world. A Siberian spiritual winter. A spiritual Siberian winter of nobody's going to spiritual gym. Everybody's goofing off. They're all delinquents. Spiritual delinquents. Pursuing smartness. They're spiritual delinquents. And they can say, yeah, we're learning lessons, blah, 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 blah. But they're not going to spiritual gym. It's a whole different thing. You look at the those who got after it back in history. Oh, you know, they went to spiritual gym big time. They loved it. They said, yeah, I got to go to gym. Well, when did you go to gym this morning? For a couple hours? Sure. I want to do a couple more this evening. Wow. And there's some gym rats that just hang out. Spiritual gym, just hang out. That's all they do. Well, they get the results, don't they? So this is like spiritual gym. This is like a spiritual gym here on YouTube. And thanks to YouTube for providing the service, for sure, because we're using it in the right way. A genius is using it in the right way. Spiritual genius is using it in the right way. And that will be beneficial to everybody. All these spirits who are curious about smartness, about delay, about how can they delay awakening, Eventually, they'll change their minds and say, hey, how can we not delay? How can we end delay? And at that point, the momentum of all of this will be a benefit down the road somehow, no doubt about it. So they're ultimately supporting their own awakening, even though they're not aware of it necessarily. And we do, the Holy Spirit, of course, uses any little bit of willingness we have. So little bits and pieces are happening to everybody, right? Synchronicities. I've had some amazing ones recently. I can't even, a couple of them are pretty astonishing. I was going to throw something away. And somebody came walking across the parking lot. And I've seen him occasionally, and they said, hey, how are you? He says, how are you? Very good. And I just mentioned him, said, hey, I'm just throwing this thing away. And he goes, oh, huh? Really? Well, you're throwing it away? What's wrong with it? I said, well, it doesn't work, and, you know, we can't get to work. And he goes, oh, huh? Well, look, mind if I take a look at it? And I said, oh, yeah, sure. And I took a look, and I said, hey, you know, why, you think you can fix it? He says, yeah, I think I can. So I said, why don't you take it then? Take it. And it was worth a lot of money. Something really nice. You said, really? I said, yeah. I said, oh, great, thanks. I think I can fix it. He's good at fixing stuff. So if he and I had not walked out synchronously at that very moment, et cetera, and greeted one another, he never would have gotten that. And I never would have had the satisfaction of knowing that somebody got something for free like that. And he's helped me out in the past, so I was more than happy. It's just amazing. I mean, rarely do we see each other or say anything. And the fact that right there, we were both there at that moment, walking to, our paths just met right at that point, and I spoke up, ended up, he got that freebie, you know. It was very synchronous, very synchronous. Today, I also walk into a place, and these customers complaining about this car dealership, this place of business. That's so terrible. And then someone else said, yeah, I've been there, it's terrible. And someone else, all these people are saying, yeah, it is terrible. And I said, oh my gosh, I was going to take my car there today. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, synchronous. Amazing. And we're looking to buy something in a store. We see someone putting this thing back they've been carrying. They put it back on the shelf, and it ends up that's exactly what we needed to buy. We couldn't find anything else, and this thing turns out to be the very thing we were looking for, the only thing that works. And someone had brought to our attention by putting, it was the only one there was. It was the only one, they were carrying it around. They put it back. It was the only one there was. It's like we just happened to be there just that moment. So these kind of synchronicities get our attention. They're attention getters, of course. So, under the surface, everyone is moving forward slowly. There's a massive current of the Holy Spirit is moving everyone towards awakening, towards Buddhahood, toward Christhood, Christ consciousness. But this is slow. It's a slow ocean current, and you know it's a slow boat, and we can put ourselves through a lot of travail. Meanwhile, so it's way better to go to spiritual gym and push the issue. And Buddha said, and he's talking about the path, he says, this is what happens. It actually is very interesting. He said, I had never understood it explained so well. He said it started out by practicing generosity, these virtues, these basic kindness and generosity, especially generosity. And I said, why? And he said, because this way you get used to giving up your thought patterns and beliefs and mistakes in your mind. You become used to non-attachment, the capacity to give these things up that you think are so valuable to you. And I said, oh my gosh, it's so true. Like recently, I gave up all the golf balls I had, and I was really attached to those, very attached. Like the past, those represent past reactions and thinking and all this stuff. I donated so much. I've donated so much in my life and given so much, and it's been very difficult to give this stuff up. But I now see that, he said, it's the habit. You get in this habit of giving up what you think is valuable to you. But ultimately, that is really intended towards these mental habits of smartness, giving up smartness altogether. So you cultivate these virtues. You start out on the path in this way. And I said, wow. Well, very, very good understanding. The Shakyamuni Buddha was a very, very keen, aware of the habits we have, and he was very pragmatic. This genius, this is spiritual genius, very, very pragmatic. That's very helpful, very helpful. Same as Jesus, very pragmatic, spiritual genius, pure spiritual genius. Understanding how to pragmatically help us and move us forward. Love one another, Jesus talked about. Love your neighbor as yourself. He gave us some, how to get started. If you do something for yourself, do something for your neighbor. But these are not goals in themselves, really. They start good habits, is what it is. And so what Buddha was all about was building good habits. Gautama Buddha, Siddhartha Buddha, Shakyamuni, same Buddha they're talking about. Building good habits. And then these good, it's just like exercise. The more exercise you do, the better shape you get. The more new exercises suggest themselves to you. For example, working on the golf swing today, I'd be able to get my hands now really high above my head. Like, I couldn't do that before at all. And in doing so, the swing gets better and better. And I said, oh my gosh, when I put my hands up above my head, every time I swing, it's a great swing. And if I don't get them high enough like that, no, it's not such a good swing. I realized, wow. And so let me practice then more flexibility and practice this way. Get those hands above the head. You automatically, you build on your good habits automatically. You just say, okay, that's easy now. Oh, I see an even better habit. It's just like that. So I recommend good habits very highly. Super important, because you will certainly recognize even better habits and then get into those. And then from there, even better habits. Ultimately, the habit of just abidance, genius, abiding in genius. You say, hey, this would be a really, really great habit, ultimate habit. Let me do this one. I was waiting today, standing in the gutter by a curb, and I said, hey, wait a minute, let me just jump up on the curb, jump up, jump down, jump up, jump down. So I did that, hop up, hopping like a bird, up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. Whew, until my legs were burning. I said, wow. And I took about, I was hopping for maybe a minute or so, but great little workout. I said, that's a nice habit. Use your downtime. Don't just, like, right now people are just like, playing some game on their phone, just everybody. Stretch, stretch, stretch. Keep working on flexibility. Put your feet up on something and really stretch your back and your legs like that, and stretch out, flexible, hop, 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 hop. Get spring in your step. Get spring in your step. This is really important, because it's a habit that has a spiritual corollary to it. It sort of reflects, kind of get your mirror, work on getting your mirror clear, and having a spring in your step. It gives us some sort of confidence. So you can pivot quickly, spring in your step. Oh, get out of the way. It brings a spiritual consciousness of, I can get it, I can jump out of the way. And this is very important to have this consciousness, the feeling of confidence, I can jump out of the way. At an instant's notice, I can jump out of the way. Because spiritually, we may need to spiritually jump out of the way of smartness, breaking this excuse that, like a shadow, catastrophe is the shadow of smartness, actually. It's the shadow that follows smartness around, just like shadows follow our bodies around as we walk around. We may not be aware of it. How often are we aware of our shadow? Not very often. I go years without even paying attention, being aware of it, that I'm casting a shadow, really. And one day you walk along, the sun hits it just right, and there's, and you say, what's that? It's like, whoa, what's that? It's our shadow. It's so, smartness has a shadow. Smartness has a shadow. And it's catastrophe. Catastrophe is the shadow of smartness. This is very true. It's a truism. So we may need to be able to just quickly jump out of the way of that. So lightening up and getting the spring in your step. This is why the Holy Spirit gave me this rope, kept having people give me rope. Hey, it's important. Get, put this rope. Get rope, 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 rope. Jump rope, jump rope. It's been a genius move, a real genius move, because it takes virtually no time at all. But it's these quick little workouts. Just, you can just throw so many in a day, really. I'm doing more and more a day. I don't know how many I've done, but I'll do more. And it's so quick. Just do a couple minutes and you're done. And it puts spring into your step. Spring into your step. Spring into your body. And we're so identified with our body, it's not a bad idea to have some spring into it right now as we go into the spring of 2016. We're already turning the corner here in California. It feels like winter is already starting to recede. Yeah, it is. It is already starting to recede. We're starting to go to the upper 50s now in the daytime and in the lower 40s at night. And the birds are starting to sing. A lot of birds around chirping, chirping, chirping. And so here comes springtime. We better have spring on our step. I mean, they're playing golf in Hawaii. And so don't wait this year. If there's one year you don't want to procrastinate, this is the year. Maybe you procrastinate all the years of your life, but not this one. So of course you're gonna feel like, oh wow, I jump right, you know, are you kidding me? That, well, I mean, yeah, the first couple of steps are the most difficult. This is what Jesus always emphasizes. He says, you know, when you start on it down on the path of good habits, the first couple of steps are always the most difficult. Once you do those, then it gets pretty easy, actually. Now it's getting easier and easier and easier for me. Not difficult at all. Yes, at times, of course, you say, I'm not sure I want to do that. But then it's pretty easy to just say, yeah, I think I will. And so once you get the good habits rolling, then you can keep them rolling. It's getting it started that's the difficult part. So you have to have some really strong, strong push within you to do it. And I would say this 2016, if this doesn't provide a strong push, I don't know what does. I don't know what does. I mean, there are so many catastrophes. The shadow of smartness is coming in so many ways. Many ways that we don't even are aware of. But certainly, one of them is just the fact that we believe that we're increasing the odds in the favor of the ego, that the odds are increasing in favor of the ego, ultimately finding what it's searching for, which is some aspect of insanity that isn't insane. That's true, you know. Just because the number of people, the number of bodies, the number of planets, the capacity of technology to expand our search. It's just that technology gives us the capacity to expand our search. And so we plausibly infer that this is increasing our odds of finding what we're searching for. It doesn't increase our odds at all. There's 0% odds. Zero odds we'll ever find any lies that are true. But the illusion, the plausible inference is that the odds are increasing because we're expanding our search. So this is a catastrophe. This is a terrible catastrophe in terms of delay. The only catastrophe there is delay. That's it. But increasing our delay is indeed a catastrophe for our suffering. So delay is exponentially increasing right now. And so this is a catastrophe. So you have that. You have the presidential election in the United States, for example. I don't know how that's going. I haven't paid any attention. I don't know who's in and who's out or whatever. But, you know, that could end up a severe catastrophe too. Maybe no matter how it turns out, it will be, you know, really, right? Just like, it just gets worse and worse. You get even worse liar, you know, in charge. Worse shadow. And then there's, you know, they're just, 2016 is again, it is not a year to trifle with. At all. Don't trifle with this year. The Holy Spirit was so adamant with me back on August 29th saying, it's go time right now. What you gonna do? Put me on the spot. What you gonna do? Decision time. You've been thinking about it. Make a decision now. What did I do all summer? I ate pigged out, whatever I wanted to eat. I was great. It was great. Every day, hot dogs. Well, veggie hot dogs with a ton of mustard and everything else. And cake and ice cream and milkshakes and soda pop. I had ice cream every night, sometimes three times a day. I was just whatever I wanted to eat, just pigged out. Absolutely pigged out. Hamburgers every day. Garden burgers, but I made the best garden burgers in the world. It was just, I had the best buns. That's the key to it, really. I have to special order them now, but we were special ordering them, and wow, just knocking it out of the park with those hamburgers. And so I went through that and gained a ton of weight, and Holy Spirit said, okay, that's fine. He told me, go for it, do that. It's important that you just chocolate. I was like taking chocolate bars and making smoothies out of them. Seriously. That was good. Really good. Dark chocolate with milk. Milk, I take this dark chocolate bars, these, you know, what, 80% dark chocolate or whatever, and just put them in the NutriBullet and make smoothies out of them. It was like thick, thick syrup, like molasses or something. And just drink that. Oh, wow. Eat some walnuts with that. Put some whipped cream on it. Whipped cream on everything. Yeah, put whipped cream on everything. A strawberry shortcake. We were just picking out on that. Come on. Everything. So and then it said August 29th. Okay, what you going to do now? And it's go time. Decision time. And I said, wow. Okay, I guess I got one more burst of will in me. Let me see if I can do it. I'll give it my best shot. And you know, rest is history. Four months are in the books, and so far so good. So I'm just giving this heads up. Don't trifle with 2016. Don't even think about it. Smartness will say, "Well, I got a way around it. You know, I got a way around my shadow." No, it doesn't. Smartness casts a big shadow. Like Dylan said, Mama, take these guns off of me. I can't shoot them anymore. There's a big dark cloud coming down towards me. You know, I can't take it anymore. So I'm knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. There's a big dark cloud coming down. There's a big dark cloud coming down. However the song went, this is the gist of it. There's a big dark cloud coming down. What is this? This is the shadow of smartness, which is catastrophe. It's the Hindenburg. It's the Titanic. It's catastrophe. These are symbols of smartness. What was the Titanic all about? Smartness. The people were so puffed up with arrogance about their smartness. As we built the smartest boat in history. Unsinkable. That's how smart we are. Well. And the Hindenburg, also very, look at this, ultimate in luxury. You look at the advertisers, the Hindenburg, my gosh, the luxury on board was extraordinary. Really, it was, the cabins, I mean, the kitchens, the dining room. I mean, this, what a way to travel. I mean, it was. I just look at that, I said, wow, how cool would that be to float in blimps like that as a way of travel? I would love to travel like that. That would be awesome. way better than an airplane. I mean, as far as aesthetically. Good grief. They were just slowly, just gracefully floating over, you know, and just in the lap of luxury with these large windows. They had huge bay windows, so to speak, looking out on the landscape in the clouds. I mean, this is, if they could ever perfect blimps, you know, let's go. So, they, you know, they wouldn't have this problem. Fabulous way. But it was very, very smart. And oops. Hindenburg. So, smartness meets its match, you know, it meets its shadow. Smartness meets its shadow eventually. Yeah, this long dark shadow's coming over me or coming down on me. I feel like something. So, this is the shadow. And the shadow of smartness is likely to hit real, real hard. Now, because this is a, you know, extraordinary commitment to smartness here in this world. And that brings about an extraordinary necessity for an excuse, the shadow of an excuse to blame futility on. Because smartness feels its futility inherently. And it says, and so what does it do? Well, it tries to be smart about it. And it says, hey, if I just can displace this off on the, make some excuse and say, that's the reason why I failed, then I can, then I'll get rid of this futility, feeling of futility. Oh, yeah. See? See, the scary thing is that, of course, smartness is spirit, pretending not to be spirit, but it still has all power of spirit to manifest, to bring about whatever it wants to, so it can bring about whatever excuse it wants to bring about. That's the catastrophes. And then smartness says, ah, you see, I found a way to get rid of this feeling of futility without giving up the search. How smart. But it's only temporary. In severe chaos and confusion, you're thinking, well, but you can't stay with it. And eventually you're back to smartness and you feel the futility and say, ah, that didn't work. That didn't work. What do I do now? You see, this is truth, is it not? This is what's going on, has gone on throughout the history of smartness. That's why I saw in this auditorium with everyone seated glued to their seats, I saw these two people walking up the aisle. These powerful people. One was dressed all in white, one was dressed in black. And what is the one dressed in white was smartness, you might say, trying to mimic spiritual genius. There's nothing wrong with dressing in white as a sign, symbol of spiritual genius, of course. But it was accompanied by someone dressed all in black, which is the shadow of smartness. And the two go together. So that's why I was walking up ahead of them. But I didn't have any, I may have been dressed in white, but there was no dressed in black accompanying me. So no shadow accompanying me. So these other two, smartness has the shadow, the dark side. Jung talked about that in psychology. They talk about it, that. And this is catastrophe, the shadow of smartness. And so these two are going together, and everybody was glued in their seats like, oh, we can't get up, we can't get up, we can't get up. I got up out of my seat, and everybody said, what are you doing getting out of your seat? How can you do that? You know, smartness didn't tell us, didn't give us permission to get out of our seat. And I said, well, genius gave me permission and overruled the objections of smartness. Everyone's looking at me like, who are you? What are you doing? Like that. Who are you? What are you doing? This is the reaction I get. Who do you think you are? I don't think who I am. It's just genius knows genius, so to speak. This is our true identity. There's not a thinking about who we are. There's not an understanding of who we are. There's just a genius of genius, the genius of genius. The nowness of nowness. So this dream was very profound. I found an exit. I found a go to, went backstage and found an exit out of here, out of this auditorium. I found the exit out of this auditorium where this play was going to take place. And this shadow was going to, you know, boom. Shadow of smartness is catastrophe, which can come in many guises, but it's all very bitter, ashy, very bitter in our mouths for sure. It's got a very, very nasty, nasty kick to it. Someone once told me he grew up on a farm and got kicked by a mule. He said, that was no fun, getting kicked by a mule. You don't want to get kicked by a mule. I think a couple times he broke the leg, broke the arm. You don't want to get kicked by these animals. They've got a real kick to them. Well, these catastrophes have a real kick to them. That's the kicker of smartness. So I found the exit. I saw the exit. I see it. I say, oh, yeah, there's an exit out of here. Great. Don't forget your whiteout. What can you white out today? What can you not watch today, like TV? What can I not watch today? I'm not even watching Kapalua. The Gulf of Kapalua, because that the commercials, come on. This is super, super corporate smartness stuff. It's all smartness based. Not good, not a good influence. They have all the people pick the coconuts before this tournament, you know, right? So no one gets hit by coconuts falling on their head. Because coconuts do fall. Absolutely. Yeah. So I'm gearing up. I'm gearing up. I'm putting my money where my mouth is. Gearing up. Put the faith in the Holy Spirit, see what happens. I'm trying to do everything possible to increase preparation, readiness, spring in my step. It's just a good metaphor. It's just a good excuse. It's a great excuse. I use golf as a great excuse. I gotta get ready for golf. Who knows if I'll even play or not. But I'm upgrading towards white out. White with no shadow. Not smart white, genius white, true light, not pretend light, not electromagnetic white, so to speak, but true light, true white. Getting more white clothes, for instance. White this, white that. White without a shadow. Non-dual white. Go non-dual white. So, spiritual gym. We've done our spiritual gym work for today, haven't we? Hour and a half. It's a nice workout. I've got to work tomorrow, so I'm not going to press it. It's Friday night, but I had to take a day off this week. So I have to work on Saturday. But again, if you attend spiritual gym, you have to feel very good about yourself, right? Because this is the real workout that we need, the true workout that we need. Otherwise, we'll get swallowed up by the whale of smartness. Spend too long in the belly of that beast. And then here comes the shadow. The big dark cloud coming down on me. Wow. I feel like I'm knocking on heaven's door. We better keep knocking. We better find the exit. And there most certainly is. I've seen it. There most certainly is. So, get that spring in your step. Don't fritter away 216. That will be a mistake. Big mistake. Don't let smartness tell you, well, you're smarter than that. You don't need to do that. You're smarter than that. No, that's stupidity. That's insanity. Don't fritter 216 away. Get some good habits rolling. This is so important. Whatever your good habits are, find more good habits. Get them rolling. Get them rolling this year. Absolutely do not drift in 216. Do not drift. Have good habits and then just be adamant about it. I'm going to stick with these good habits, period, for 216. Got to do it. Get them rolling, whatever they are. Okay. And have more than just one, maybe. You have more than have several good habits. I try to have, you know, the spiritual gym, and then physically have some a good physical habit too. Good habits physically. Try to stick with, you know, eat really well, as healthy as possible. Work on flexibility and springiness. Not muscularity, but springiness. Work on springiness. I found out that I had lost springiness. I tried to spring. I couldn't do it. The Holy Spirit said, "Jump up on this ledge here." I said, "Oh, okay." I started. I tried. I said, "I can't. I couldn't. I couldn't try." I said, "What's wrong?" I said, "I don't think I can do it. I got all panicky. I can't." I said, "Where's the spring in my legs? Oh my gosh, I should be able to easily just jump up on that ledge." Gone is the spring. Spring of our lives is gone. However, we can get it back to a certain extent. We may not be as springy as we were when we were young, but we can get close to it, actually. And that's good enough. The very act of springing up itself reminds us of youth. It really does. This is why one of the benefits of this. I found this, like jumping up on the curb. I said, "Hey, I used to do that when I was a kid." Or jumping up on anything. I said, "Oh my gosh, that reminds me of when I was young." So we want to remind ourselves. Now, of youth before we succumb to smartness, okay? Now, one thing I did forget here was very important. Very, very important. Another genius move today. I said, "Holy Spirit, just across the board diminish my smartness, free me from smartness across the board, not in any way in particular or any way special, but just the entire gamut spectrum of what I am, just lighten me up across the board a little bit, in every way." You see, a general lightening up. This is what I said to the Holy Spirit. I don't want anything in particular strong to stand out, but just an overall general lightening of my total being. Just lighten it all up to a certain extent. I didn't say totally or a lot or anything. I just said lighten it all up a bit. All of it. All of it. All of it. All of it. All at once. All together. All synchronous. Concurrently, just this overall lightening up. And I realized before, I'd never asked that before. I've always said, "Can you help me in this way? Can you help me in this way?" I said, "Help me in all ways. In all ways. Lighten me up in all ways. All facets. Lighten all facets up. Together. All together. Not as a sequence, as a linear sequence, or this follows that, or as a process, all at once, just lighting it all up together, just instant. And so this is what I was asking the Holy Spirit for today. And I said, wow, this is a genius move, real genius move to look at it this way. No question about it. It's a milestone. So good for you for hanging in all the way to hear this at the very end. Oftentimes at the very end, there's something like this that's really important. And maybe that's the exit that we're looking for, is the willingness to ask the Holy Spirit to do that. Just lighten all facets up, all aspects up, concurrently, synchronously, in a synchronous way, in a synchronous, concurrent, all facets, all aspects, all of me, lighten all of me up, all of me, together like that. A little bit, as much as I'm comfortable with, just. And I said, yeah, oh my gosh, isn't that going back to youth, so to speak, the spring, the true spring? Isn't this springtime in our spirits? Is it not springtime in our spirits to look at it this way? Yes, it is. The winter is ending. The winter is coming to an end. When we ask the Holy Spirit for this, though, we're turning the corner on this long, dark, cold winter with these terrible shadows of smartness that have been cast upon us. We are turning the corner out of that, most definitely. And that may have been behind the stage. As I turned the corner, I saw, oh, there's an exit there. I said, thank God there's an exit there. Wow. And this feels like this is it. To ask for this. I've never prayed in that way before. Asked. No, never like that. I never even thought of that before. And so I was like, wow, that's a winner. And this is a winner of a video, isn't it? I didn't know how I'd do today. I felt almost like not doing it. Ah, it's Friday. Let me listen to some music or something. And no. I said, come on, let me jump some rope and then do this video. Let's knock it out of the park. Okay, that's enough. My throat is starting to act up. That's enough. That's a sign the wow is sufficient. Wow. Wow. Okay, we will end on that great high note. Perfect time to end. Very great. That's it for this one. Have a wow weekend.